morning. We've got a lot to do this morning, but as always, we're going to start with some art. So we're going to actually start with a van burst this morning. And to tell you a little bit about it, I want to bring up the original project manager for van. Some of you may know, some of you newer to the network may not know, but give a big round of applause for Ann Kaufman.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm really excited to be back here after like 5 years, and I'm here representing the Adeline Edwards Foundation, which is based in New Orleans. And it is a foundation that supports the alumni of YaYa, it's a youth arts organization that's been thriving in New Orleans for the past 3 years. And I'm introducing one of the artists that we support through the Adeline Edwards Foundation, Ron Theron Ratliff. He's going to be giving his art course. And I am so excited to introduce him because I have had the privilege of working with Ron Theron for the past 25 years, off and on throughout his career. We first met in New Orleans. I was fresh out of college. I got my first job at YaYa as a junior staff member. And Ron Theron was a high school student who was a freshman. And we had a commission to do a mural on the wall of his high school, which is around the corner from our organization. And there was this really tall wall, it's 3 stories high, and we were painting the entire height of this wall. And so I rented an elevator lift, a crow's nest, and all of the other artists were terrified. It would not get in that crow's nest. And he was the only one who would step into this, and he, you know, went all the way up to the top and spent days there painting. And it was just magical and amazing to see his fearlessness. And he painted this beautiful face of every child. It was the face of a young person that was ebony on one side and faded to alabaster, holding the world above his or her head. And it was just a lovely sight, the process in and of itself, and that image of him painting that is forever engraved in my mind. And that was how we met. And last year, through the Adeline Edwards Foundation, which is a new foundation, I was excited that I was able to broker my past relationships with Van and introduced Ron Theron to Rosie Gordon Wallace from Diaspora Vibe Cultural Arts Incubator in Miami, where she is right now for Art Basel. And she invited Ron down to Miami, and he had a residency there, which was his entree into really focusing solely on his own practice. For years, he'd been working at YaYa. He returned in a leadership position as a mentor. And Rosie took him and gave him a studio space, and he was able to work practically 24 hours a day through the night. And he's been creating amazing works, and it's really created this fabulous domino effect of opportunities. He exhibited on Governor's Island this past summer, and he's here to tell you about what he's been up to. So, Ron Theron, please come to the stage.
The work that I do is mixed media assemblages, sculptures, using my association and the Jews association with these objects to sort of create narratives. And the win for me would be, I guess, creativity is something that I grew up around. My mom was always a maker, my dad was a builder, and so that was just kind of second nature. But like Han said, that talent was fostered through the Incox program with Yaya. And during that experience, I had an opportunity to meet an artist by the name of John Scott, who passed away. But that visit to his studio and the talk with him as a teenager, it showed me who I wanted to be. It was like his passion for art making and his commitment to young artists and artists in general was just like, I admired that and aspired to just to be that. And so that was a sort of kind of confirming moment for me to know, like, this is what I want to do. And I mean, I still didn't have a clear direction, but it was like, someday I want to be there, you know? And so that was, it was part of the beginning. And in 2005, I entered into a more contemporary art practice, and it was a response to the flooding in New Orleans. And so for me, that was an opportunity to sort of, well, I'll go back. I existed in art from a commercial art practice. And so in 2005, I began to work in a contemporary art practice. And that allowed me to work from a place of sharing. And so my first piece was about sharing my experience through that natural disaster. And so that process of sharing is what leads me through all the other work that I do, and it, you know, it functions as therapy, questioning, curiosity, and I mean, I guess the why. I'm interested in, the human condition and like why we do what we do. And often my work starts with the why, and maybe if I am satisfied with the answer, I'll consider it complete. Or if I haven't received an answer or come to an answer, the work exists as a question that maybe the audience can help me answer. And so that's been my approach to the work. I'll tell you a little bit about the images you saw. I started a series called Can't Call Home when I was in Miami, and that was kind of looking at the sort of, the displacement that exists in New Orleans and my association with what home means. And so being in Miami and thinking about home, I started this body of work, and it was sort of it was a weird thing. I was in Miami, so I hadn't traveled in a long time, and I traveled a lot with the youth program, and every time I would travel, my mom would be like, oh, call me when you get there, I'll let you know you made it there, all right. And I don't know, as a young teenager, I was like, oh, why do I need to call you? Like, if something happens, someone will call you, you know? And so that was this thing we had, like, if I don't call you, that means that everything's all right, you know? And so I hadn't traveled for a while, and going to Miami was the first time, and I was in Miami, and so now I'm contemplating, like, oh, should I call her? But during this time after the storm, my mom, she had like a, she began to suffer from like delusional disorders. And so, and there was a lot of stuff that led up to it. But that was just something, so you have to kind of come to terms with it because the person is kind of losing their sort of sense of identity and their associations with the world around them. And so, so this idea of like calling home, you know, it's kind of like, well, I don't know, that person isn't there anymore. And so, how I function with her, like, you know, I don't know, before that was like it had to be a face-to-face for her to sort of know who I am. So that was, I don't know, that's where that series came from. But,
that looks at the physical, the emotional, the cultural costs of displacement. We're going to have a session today entitled Displacement, Imagining New Models for Growth. I'm Carra Martinez. I'm the Director of Community Engagement at the Guthrie Theater. And Minneapolis is now my home base, and I've spent a lot of years there in school and working at theaters like the Number Theater. But my hometown is Austin, Texas. And a lot of time on I-35. And in Austin, I've worked for many years as an artist, but for 2 years in particular, I worked with Ron Berry and Brad Carlin at Fusebox Festival. And we worked on a project called Think East. And Think East imagined how art might shape, intervene, shift discussions around displacement. So what we're going to offer for you today is a kind of series or strategies, methods for engaging this conversation in a way that surfaces the history of neighborhoods, that acknowledges complexity, and that allows us to both think logically and also think creatively about displacement. When we were creating this conversation, we had kind of a series of three agreements in terms of how we would go about it. First, in this conversation, we're going to focus on lived experience as a site of knowledge production. Second, we are going to honor, we're going to focus on Austin, so in large part, we're going to honor local context and local languages. Rather than ask folks to shape their stories and shape their languages with ideological frameworks and languages that might recenter their lived experience on Western-centric ideas, we're gonna let people speak from their point of view. And so you'll hear the word displacement, but you'll also hear the word gentrification, because in East Austin, we use the word gentrification. These activities that you're going to participate in part, are designed to decentralize power structures. So you'll hear us like doing the thing where we're talking. But also, we're gonna get up and do some stuff. So our first activity is called a social networking activity. Then you'll hear a little panel discussion. And then we're gonna do, call it crowdsourcing bold ideas. So you're gonna have to get up a little, then you can sit back and listen, and then you'll get up again. Social networking. This is an activity designed to prompt immediate engagement around the idea of displacement. It surfaces the very lived experiences in the room and it emphasizes the possibilities in new conversation. So, we are going, let me see where Brad is on this. We are going to ask you to think about two questions, and we'll get started. I'll just read these to you. We'll put them up in just a moment. The questions are, what is a challenge that your community faces related to displacement? And the second question is, how have you seen displacement addressed in an interesting and meaningful way? Those are really big questions. So if you want to just focus in on one, that's fine. There's no right or wrong. Interpret those questions as they make sense in terms of your lived experience. So one of the things we learned when doing these activities is that time is a really interesting thing in working with people. If you're like me, I like to think long and slow, then I might want to write about it, then I want to have like an existential crisis about what I wrote. These activities are like, you get up and you go, and time matters. And it gets you out of sort of your ruts of thinking. So I'm gonna give you a minute, and I'm gonna time it, to ponder one of those two questions. We're gonna do it in silence, okay? So you have 1 minute to come up with a little beginning of thought about what is the challenge that your community faces related to displacement, or how have you seen displacement addressed in an interesting and meaningful way? So 1 minute, I'm gonna time, go. In each round, repeat the same pattern. You're gonna walk around and find someone that you don't know. And for 2 minutes, you are going to speak your thoughts however they come out. Don't worry about it, just share. And then we're gonna switch and your partner shares their thoughts for 2 minutes. Now, I saw this activity where we were up and moving yesterday, and time is not our strength. We like to go long. So I'm gonna ask you as you move, that you stay aware of my voice on the mic and time. Because we really do want this to go quickly. The quickness, the moving changes the way that you think and talk. All right? So, find a partner. Find a new person.
Hello.
All right. And 2 minutes begins.
Thank you.
Boston is struggling with a lot of things that growing cities are, not maybe as rapidly as Boston, but definitely, I mean, there's a lot of young people that come to Boston from all of the different colleges and universities.
So we have all right, wrap it up. And the next person begins speaking in the partnership. The other person begins to speak.
Thank you. conversation where you met an interesting person, where you perhaps heard some things that you were like, yes, that's it. Or perhaps you heard something that made your shoulders go up and you were like, ooh. If we're always comfortable in this conversation, then we're not having an honest discussion. So part of activities like this is they disorient people a little bit, and that's great because it gets you out of your habits of thought. Hold on to the good things that you heard. We're going to return to some of those ideas with our final activity. But now we have some panelists joining us on stage to sort of talk with us about their lived, artistic, personal experience with ideas like displacement and gentrification. The way the panel's going to work is we're going to start talking about Austin, and then we're going to broaden it to discuss national and international ideas. Before I introduce the panelists, I want to kind of situate you really quickly in Austin's history. Because like, this is a hip cool town, there's good tacos. But there's a deeper history beyond that. I want to name that Austin was established by the Republic of Texas to do three things. To create a center from which to stage the genocide of Native Americans, to stop the northward expansion of the Mexican government, and to create a new space in which to spread slave-based agriculture. And that's the foundation of the history of this city. So when we talk about displacement in this current moment, you should know that's the whole history of Austin. Different kinds of displacement. After the Civil War, when there were a number of freedmen communities around town, and those were in areas that are now like our hippest, coolest neighborhood. Eventually, as real estate prices rose, all those freedmen communities were displaced east of the freeway in a neighborhood that we roughly call East Austin. That process was given city policy structure, stamp of approval in 1930 with a city plan. Initially, the Latino, or what you would say in Austin, the Mexican neighborhood in Austin, was really small, and it was south where City Hall sits now in a neighborhood called Mexico. Creative name. And eventually, that also, over time, as the Mexican population grows in Austin, it also gets through sort of de facto and overt Jim Crow policies, it also gets displaced into East Austin. In East Austin, in the early 1980s, you see the way that the government worked, the policy that the government had, there were no paved roads in large parts of East Austin. In the 80s. No sewage service to large parts of East Austin, and the school systems, like the radical difference in west to east in school services was and is pretty profound. As the neighborhood kind of begins to get resources, in the late 80s and 90s, a lot of artists, and you know this pattern, right? A lot of artists move into East Austin, and now it's one of the fastest gentrifying neighborhoods in America. The whole city is being displaced. Don't let me, as economic power comes into the city center, everybody is being pushed out. And it feels like a real crisis moment, but I just want to point to that it has always been a crisis moment for a lot of people in the city, especially people of color. So I just wanted to frame that for you. We're going to start our conversation with these folks and get out some introductions. Lulu, raise your hand. This is Lulu Flores. She's a longtime political activist and attorney and a partner at Hendler Lyons Flores in Austin, Texas, and is the past president of the National Women's Political Caucus. She is currently a commissioner on the Austin Arts Commission. Welcome, Lulu, please. Raise your hand, please. A native of Ethiopia, now an artist living and working in both Austin and Rio, Betty Makonnen is a conceptual artist whose research deals with the perennial question of existence. She currently works primarily in photography, video, and installations, but has no loyalty to any medium. Her loyalty is to process. Ron is the executive and artistic director of Fusebox Festival. Using principles of grassroots organizing and equitable development processes, for the past 3 years, Fusebox Festival has led the planning and visioning process for Think East, a new multi-use development on the site of a former environmental brownfield in East Austin. Welcome, Ron. Gayle, raise your hand, Gayle. Gayle Issa is the Executive Director of Asian Arts Initiative, a multidisciplinary community arts center in Philadelphia that engages people of all ages and backgrounds to create and present art that addresses Asian American experience. Welcome, Gayle, please. And then, Celso, raise your hand, please. Celso Curi is a producer, cultural administrator, journalist, agent, and cultural advisor based in Brazil. He's the former president of LaRed, a network created in order to generate and provide space for joint work between producers in the areas of contemporary dance, theater, and music in Latin America and the Caribbean. So again, this is our panel, but we're going to start with local context, and we're focusing on everyday lived experiences, the day-to-day. So my first question is for the three Austinites. And you can take it in any order you want, and also if you want to stop me and change the question or ask each other questions, that's fine. What has been your lived experience in Austin navigating displacement and gentrification?
I guess I'll start since I'm the senior person living in Austin, and I actually have lived in Austin over 40 years, and I've seen a lot of changes in that time. I grew up in Laredo, Texas, on the border, and it was a pretty homogenous city, with Latinos being obviously 95%. When I got to Austin, it was a very different experience, of course. I was in undergraduate school and law school, but while I was in law school, I worked for the first Mexican-American elected to the Texas legislature ever. So, and that was 1976 that that happened. So, you know, I basically lived the experience of seeing when I first got to Austin, going over and getting lost in East Austin because I didn't know where I was going, and actually seeing the barricade of IH-35 and seeing the community as it existed and seeing the disparity. Really, it was like you get one Austin west of I-35 and a completely different Austin east of I-35, or East Avenue as it was known. And you heard reference to, you know, the history of Republic Square and which used to be Guadalupe Park in that area called Mexico, and the East Austin corridor, the Fifth Street corridor, where you had, you know, Mexican activity, but they were actually displaced purposefully, as was mentioned. And I lived that experience because I got involved early on in the politics of East Austin, mostly with the Latino community, of course, and seeing those differences and disparities in school funding, in just the infrastructure. It was just a very frustrating experience to live in. Now, more recently as an arts commissioner, and still as a Latina living in Austin, I see communities of color being displaced east of I-35, and of course it's part of economics, right? The land, its proximity to downtown and great areas, but nevertheless, these are homes, these are communities, these were centers, although they were forced to, you know, or involuntarily relocated east of I-35, they made it their home and their communities and our power bases for our communities were in those neighborhoods and in those communities. So it's very sad to really feel a sense of loss. And I work with a Hispanic bar, and we have kids writing essays, eighth graders, about what is the most important legal issue in their community, and some chose gentrification. And it's just seeing the despair and not understanding why, you know, they are not able, and their parents aren't able to keep their homes after having lived there so long, and after having suffered the injustices of not ever having any attention paid to that community. So it's a real, there's a sense of loss for me, for that community. I don't live in that neighborhood, but, you know, I grew up there basically through my political ties and, you know, and building, you know, trying to build a power structure for Latinos here in Austin. I was just saying how I was so shocked when I was reading a research paper about how it happened, all, you know, the systematic and the mechanics of how it actually took place legally and with the intent. And that's just shocking to me, even though I lived it and understood it. You know, seeing how systematic it was is even shocking to me at this time. And it's a real education and lesson for me as to thinking about the things that we need to do in the future, maybe to make restitution and reparation for those things and work together to maybe figure out ways that these communities can work. And I think artists being the visionaries of our communities and creative thinkers can help forge alliances and work through the political process to maybe come up with solutions that can help ease the pain and move forward together.
My name is Betelhem Makonnen, and I'm going to be speaking more as an artist and, as Lulu said, more about art's possible relationship to coming up with solutions for displacements or having responses to displacement. I am Ethiopian American. I am not a native Austinite. That is a very important distinction we need to make. I came to Austin in the 90s to go to school at UT, and had the same experience that Lulu had, that she talked about, this the divide of I-35 and just how drastic that was. And for me, it was almost there was a time change because it just seemed rural on east of 35. And at school, I had many different diverse group of friends. And one thing was how rare it was for us to have a black friend that was from Austin. And at UT, there just seemed to be a wall that separated that experience. And so I wanted to actually share three thoughts with you. I think when we talk about gentrification and displacement, we have to see it connected to the larger context. It has to do with distribution of power and resources. And I think about it, I lived, after being here in the 90s, I lived in different cities, other countries, and I recently moved back to Austin after living 15 years in Brazil. And my experience being in other countries and seeing the process of displacement is interesting because both in Rio and in Addis, which is my native city, displacement or development tends to happen through the government, so construction is slower. And really, it gives you a different sense and understanding of the impact of this economic phenomenon. We can talk about it on the macro level as an economic phenomenon that's always going on. But when you're in a place like Rio or Addis, and you see how neighborhoods are removed slowly, meaning the memory is not erased from one day to the next. It takes time. So you see buildings cut in half, homes where a bedroom is just standing and grass is growing in it. So it has a feeling of a war zone. And you tend to connect the impact of displacement and gentrification with war. And for the people who are experiencing it, that is how it feels. And time has slowed down in a way, or in Rio during the preparations for the Olympics, the way that the neighborhoods were moved, again, happens in a slow way because development is different there. And you experience it in that sense. I mean, it puts trauma on your body, you see it. Where here, every time I'm driving to my studio on East Cesar Chavez, the landscape changes like within a week. And I go, was that place there? I don't remember, you know? But for somebody who's experiencing it, of course they remember. They know their memories are being erased. The other thing I wanted to say was, my daughter was telling me, she goes, but Mom, we talk about these things. She said, well, you suffered displacement too when the revolution happened and you moved here. I mean, you lost everything as well. I said, well, there's something different there. I mean, that happened to my whole country. Everybody went through that experience together, collectively. And there's something different when the experience is happening to one part of the population. And around, everything else is going differently except in that space with those people. So the experience is felt in a different way, and your relationship to it is different. Third thing, just in the complexity of the layers, I was reading something, I don't know if it was online or in a periodical, and it was about two artists talking about a residency they're doing in Marfa. And something about what they said struck me, which is they were saying how they were talking about what they were doing, but they said they love being in the middle of nowhere, and they're creating their work in the middle of nowhere. And I think that's significant. It's not nowhere. It's a place. It has a history, and there's people there. And sometimes when people enter a new space, be it, you know, through gentrification, you think of it almost like a green space, like there's nothing there till whatever it is that you are doing or building. And you have to acknowledge that there is a place there. I mean, as an artist, for me, if I'm gonna install a show in what looks like an empty gallery, I know it's not empty. It has all kinds of history, and it has a context that's been there. So those are the three things that I think about when I think about the complexities of what we're discussing. And if we don't acknowledge its complexities, then we won't have any kind of response that's worth the effort.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. So, yeah, no, there's like so much to say. Oh my God. First of all, I would say I think there are as many reasons for making art as there are people in this room. For me, I don't view art making as something separate from life. It feels very much at the center of it. It is in some ways indistinguishable for me. And I feel that as someone who's running an arts organization, I feel the same way. And so to me, it was impossible to not look at what's happening in our community every day and not be dealing with that in some way. And so it felt very essential. In fact, at the heart of who we needed to be as an arts organization to be dealing with this. We are not experts in real estate, in urban planning, any of these things, but I do think we have an ability to listen, to hold multiple vantage points simultaneously, and to think about things in different ways and outside the box. And those things actually, in this moment, in this circumstance, seem actually like great tools that can be really useful. Carra alluded to that we've been working on helping to imagine the future of this 24-acre site in East Austin, which was one of our darkest environmental chapters. It was also one of our great examples of community organizing. A handful of mainly women from the neighborhood organized. They took on the biggest oil companies in the world. They got this site shut down. It took 20 years to get it cleaned up. Oil company put it on the market, these two guys bought it, and they had a love of the arts, they wanted to do something for the arts, but they also wanted to do something for the neighborhood. And I know one of these guys for many years, and he's like, does Fusebox want to be involved? And we were like, yes, this sounds really amazing. But we also wanted to, I mean, for me, it's also from the get-go, I think really important to also recognize that, like, I'm a white middle-class guy now partnering with two developers and the city of Austin. You've heard us not have a shining, glowing record when it comes to these things. And so that's been one. I mean, we have to like talk about that. We've been working, Carra's been really indispensable in this work. But I think what we wanted to do was create a space for the neighborhood and the arts community to imagine the future of this site together. That we wanted them to drive the priorities of this site and ultimately create something that serves them in a way that is meaningful to them and is done in a way that is meaningful to them. So the process was almost just as important as the thing that we're coming up with. And we also, we thought it was meaningful that we do a festival every year, and Austin like has a gazillion friggin' festivals. Like you, like there's a moment in the spring where you literally cannot open your pantry without a festival spontaneously erupting. And so for me, that also was like, this is like a great opportunity to use a festival to look at this thing that is like really profoundly impacting our city and has been forever. So we wanted to use our festival as an opportunity to model all the ideas that had emerged from the neighborhood and the arts community about the future of the site. And we built this kind of pop-up village on site and invited the neighborhood, arts community, city out to respond to these ideas. What do you like? What do you not like? What have we not even thought about? It was also important that there were lots of different ways that people could provide additional input. It wasn't, there was opportunities to write, to build things, tell stories. There were lots of different, it was multi-sort of modal, and I thought that was really important because people react and think and want to sort of interact in different ways. I also think it's really important, before we even got involved, we went and talked to some of the women who led the fight against the oil company. We talked to neighborhood leaders and asked, is this something that you all even want? Because we didn't even want to start this process if there wasn't an interest for this to happen. And they were like, yes, but believe us, we would tell you, we are not bashful, but we really believe in this project, and they become big advocates for it. Anyway, we kind of made this master plan for the site, and now we're starting to implement it. There's going to be two significant affordable housing developments. There's a waiting list of about 450 people who have ties to that neighborhood who want to live there but can no longer live there, and they will be given priority for this housing. We also sort of wanted the neighborhood to define what affordability meant, because that word gets thrown around a lot and it means a lot of different things to different people, and so we wanted them to kind of define what that was. One of the things, the biggest thing that I learned was really that in many ways this whole project is a community health project. I think the neighborhood, like literally, it was a toxic site that was like poisoning the neighborhood. So this project has been about transforming this toxic site into a place that's healthy. But also the neighborhood has tried for decades to get health services there, and so there's a real need for real health services there. And as we began to work with leaders in the health industry, the way that they're thinking about community health is actually quite broad, and it's about participation, it's about culture, it's about open access to open space, it's about food. And so we've been working with the new med school to imagine a new kind of community clinic that's not about just churning people through, but actually about understanding the particulars of people's lives, helping them navigate the system. This is something that I desperately need. Having access to healthy food. And so that's just been, that framework has been really helpful. And in some ways kind of gets to me what is sort of one of the wicked questions, which is, you know, like Carra was saying, like actually everyone is talking about the disparity. And so like in this neighborhood, like they didn't have paved roads. They've never been able to get health services. There's still, relatively speaking, there's kind of a food desert. There's not a lot of access to healthy, affordable food. There is healthy food around, it's not affordable. And so how do we get these services and these things into the community and address these needs that they have identified without displacing the very people that need these things, and also without eradicating the culture that is so rich and vital there. So that, to me, that is like right at this. And they would also say that prior, you know, earlier their home prices were also depressed, and they're like, that was also not the ideal situation. So it's kind of, to me, this kind of wicked question at the heart of this work.
Let's open this up a little more to sort of pull back the lens with Gayle and Celso. Let me ask you, whoever would like to go first, it's great. As you've listened to this conversation, in terms of your own experience, where do you hear familiar echoes and what silences have you heard? What other ideas and experiences might we consider?
Well, I think I'm going to speak in Portuguese, it would be easier for me. Because it's very complicated to explain. Brasil is very. O Brasil é país muito diferente.
Brasil is very different
do resto do mundo. E principalmente a cidade de São Paulo, de onde eu venho.
Primer, and especially the city of São Paulo, one of the largest cities where I come from.
Onde o displacement acontece diariamente.
Where displacement does happen every day.
E que hoje é um teatro, por exemplo, amanhã é uma igreja evangélica.
So, for example, today there's a big old historic theater, and next week it's an evangelical theater, evangelical church.
Onde, por exemplo, um bairro como Bom Retiro, nos últimos 50 anos que eu venho trabalhando com arte,
there's a neighborhood called Bom Retiro, and over the last 50 years that I've been working in the city.
Já foi um bairro italiano, um bairro português, um bairro judeu, um bairro boliviano, e hoje é um bairro coreano.
So initially it was an Italian neighborhood, then it became a Portuguese neighborhood, then it was the Jewish neighborhood, and now it's a Korean neighborhood.
Então, essas mudanças acontecem muito rapidamente.
These changes are very rapid.
E estamos falando de 50 anos.
And that's only 50 years.
É completamente diferente do Rio, onde você tem uma fatia que vive no morro, que é a favela, né?
It's very different from Rio de Janeiro, where there's a big slice of the city that's the slums.
E logo abaixo, onde tem as pessoas que têm um maior poder aquisitivo. E isso, nos últimos anos, não tem mudado.
And then on the fringe, on the beach, is where all the very, you know, elite people live, and that hasn't changed.
São Paulo, nos últimos anos, tem empurrado para suas bordas.
São Paulo, in the last years, has pushed out to the periphery.
As pessoas com menos poder aquisitivo.
The people that have the most economic challenges.
Então aí as favelas ficam localizadas. Isso preserva, de uma certa maneira, a grande São Paulo como uma cidade imensa.
Na Bahia,
São Paulo.
So this is, so the interior, the inside of the city kind of remains as it is, but the outside, the periphery is where a lot of people get pushed to.
Como a construção civil e o poder econômico já não está mais satisfeito com o centro da cidade de São Paulo, ele acaba mudando para a periferia, o que expulsa de volta os pobres para o centro da cidade.
So now I'm not satisfied with being able to develop in the urban center. The urban developers, government and private, are going out to the periphery, creating nicer gated communities in those areas, and pushing poor people back into the urban centers.
E ocupam os prédios que estão fechados para até que estes prédios sejam valorizados e vendidos mais caros. Mas como os grupos estão se organizando, grupos de sem teto se organizam, eles acabam ocupando os edifícios que já têm uma infraestrutura.
So there's been a tendency for developers to purchase properties and leave them abandoned until that real estate could have greater value. And so what's happened is that they sit abandoned, and these poor communities that get pushed back into the urban centers organize, they occupy those buildings. And a lot of them are old historic buildings, and then they become occupied with people who are using them for living spaces but aren't interested in preserving the historical value of them. And so in a way, it's trapping real estate through speculation, investment speculation, and then leaving it to be occupied by people who can't possibly restore it.
Isso acabou gerando tipo de vida em São Paulo, que se criaram vários bairros de pessoas com mais dinheiro, com infraestruturas próprias, mas na periferia, onde estavam os menos favorecidos.
So you have like urban in the city of São Paulo, you have neighborhoods that are wealthier people, but then around them are these little pockets of these occupied buildings of much poorer or less resourced people who are really living on the margins.
Mas eu queria também falar pouquinho sobre a importância desses deslocamentos, desses displacement de uma outra maneira, que acaba provocando na arte olhar diferente dos seus próprios trabalhos.
I wanted to talk a little bit about how this displacement has affected arts.
Os deslocamentos na dança, nas artes visuais, têm sido fundamentais para entender essa arte mais conectada com a realidade do dia a dia.
So, for example, visual arts and dance has been really essential to helping us understand what this kind of displacement means day to day.
E nossos grupos mais experimentais no Brasil, ou em São Paulo principalmente, vou falar de São Paulo.
So the more experimental groups of artists, especially in Brazil, and I'm speaking specifically about São Paulo.
Cada vez mais, esses grupos estão utilizando o deslocamento como linguagem para se comunicar com a própria cidade onde eles vivem.
Are using this whole phenomenon of displacement as an actual language to talk about the city they live in.
My name is Gayle, and I am based in Philadelphia in the Chinatown and Chinatown North neighborhood. I wanted to thank Carra and also Lily for referencing the fact that I think the struggle around displacement is current and urgent, but it's something that has been almost constantly ongoing. And then I also want to also thank Betty or your daughter maybe for invoking also the ways that displacement is broader than just what is happening in our immediate neighborhoods, but also that is tied in with much larger world dynamics and ways that people are not allowed to stay in their countries or on their land. And so even though the focus for today, I think, is around neighborhood, just for us to be mindful of that context, as we're talking. And so I guess for HRX Initiative as an organization, I'll just give a quick background and context of who we are and sort of some of our work. I have some slides too that may be helpful for people who want something visual to look at. But we're a multidisciplinary community-based art center that was started actually as a program at the Painted Light Art Center in Philadelphia back in 1993, originally in response to racial tensions and concerns after the Rodney King verdict the year prior, and racial tensions especially between Black and Asian communities. And so for us, like our mission has always been twofold: to tell the stories of Asian Americans and also to be able to build bridges and dialogue with the even more diverse communities that we're a part of. As an organization, we were displaced ourselves by the expansion of the Pennsylvania Convention Center in the probably around like 2005-ish. And so approximately 10 years, $6 million, and like an excruciating new market tax credits process there. We are now the owner of a 24,000 square foot building in the Chinatown North neighborhood. That's what kind of NPN that hurt me over the years through the struggle of attaining this building. But now we operate it as a multi-tenant facility with a number of other sort of long-term arts organizations and community groups that rent office and studio space from us, and other folks who use our space for various kinds of rehearsals and events as well. So I definitely think that for me, one of the strategies that I would offer, I know it's not one that's always achievable, but is for those of us who can, to find ways to actually own the properties. And Carla, this is the property that we are in. I feel like that's been a refrain that I've been hearing from folks in Austin as well about sort of the challenges of being displaced. And so really for us all to think about like ways that we can sort of build strategies to actually control the site. You know, so I'm actually very envious of folks who, you know, who are in that kind of a situation of being able to do that. For us, our neighborhood is a neighborhood that's very diverse. It's Chinatown, there's a commercial core that was divided from the portion of Chinatown North where we're located by a crosstown expressway that was built in an effort in the late 70s and early 80s. And so this more industrial part, light industrial part of the neighborhood is an area that is even more, I think, diverse than the commercial core, and where Asian Americans have actually never been the majority population. Currently, there's about, according to census results, there's about 20% of the residential population that's Asian American, and a total of like 60 or more percent that's either African American or white American. And then there's even more, I think, diversity in terms of, and disparity, really in the economics and in the earlier exercise that I talked with some folks about, the example that I give of there being a homeless shelter on one side of our block and then luxury loft apartments and condos on the other side. And so I think for us, like part of our role as an arts organization has also been to physically to host and facilitate, or maybe this is a strategy as well as a role, but to be able to create an artist in residence series where we have invited artists in to help us to investigate and then also develop relationships and also develop interventions to try to find ways to connect folks from these really diverse parts of our neighborhood and put them into contact and direct dialogue with each other. So again, like having folks, you know, who might otherwise either never speak to a homeless person or who might only consider the homeless as a nuisance issue, but being able to work side by side. One of the projects that there are some images of is of a farm that was actually created by one of our artists in residence, Maylin Ng, on an unused strip of parking lot and the side of the dining hall of the shelter. And it's in. It was created a year and a half ago, and is now in its second growing season, and producing food that can be used to supplement. It's not like enough volume to actually feed everyone that the shelter feeds, but to supplement each of the meals that are offered there. I think the last project or strategy that I'll mention, before that, I'll just say a couple more things about the neighborhood. One of the other things I think that's important is actually around the naming of the neighborhood. And so right now, you hear me talking about our part of the neighborhood is Chinatown North. It's also called the Cowell Hill neighborhood by our City Planning Commission. And it's dubbed the Loft District by a number of for-profit developers. And Trestletown for the above ground viaduct. That actually many other community advocates have been working to transform into something that is being called the Rail Park, similar to New York's High Line in terms of some of the scope. And so, even though I and also HR's initiative definitely acknowledge the diversity of constituents who are part of the neighborhood and acknowledge the diversity of names that are used to describe the neighborhood. I think it's an important choice for us to use the term Chinatown North to be able to ensure that going forward, there will always continue to be a place for Asian Americans to feel like we can exist and continue to exist in this part of the neighborhood. And so then the last piece that I was just going to mention is some of the work that we're just starting to do now, where we are taking a lead role in trying to create a neighborhood cultural plan and to facilitate that process with local neighborhood stakeholders, as well as a group of kind of advisors from other parts of public policy advisors from different parts of the city, and to really hopefully be able to create a framework so that when private developers are considering projects in the neighborhood, there's kind of something that we can reflect on and use to try to either force or facilitate a dialogue and to try to shape how the neighborhood changes going forward into the future.
So you've heard this sort of broad range of experiences, personal experience, artistic experiences, talk about macro level systems, micro histories, ghosts of people and communities and cultures. We're gonna actually shift away from this talk, and I know that we could spend the rest of our time here talking, but one of the things we learned in Think East was that actually the best way in some ways to start creating grassroots movement around this thinking and building community was actually in small group conversation. That large groups like this tend to reinstate the dynamics that are already in place in a community. So we're gonna shift a little bit. Can you please thank all these panelists for coming out today? So we're going to do now one of these Ross's and mine's favorite activities, and if you teach, students are really, really good at this. On the table, you will see blank note cards. Grab a note card, and you will write a utensil. Don't put your name on it. It's not your note card. It's the universe's note card. I want you to think about this question. It's up on the screen. If you were 10 times bolder, if money and resources and logic were not at play in your thinking, your prior relationships, any sort of if you were 10 times bolder thinker, what one idea would you propose to begin to address displacement in your community? What one idea, one, not nobody's read a dissertation for your own health, sure. But what one idea would you propose to address displacement in your community? In one or two impossible sentences to write, we know this is hard, write your answer. Not your name, just your answer. You have about a minute to get it down. In like 20 more seconds. All right, wrap up that thought. So in a moment, I'm going to ask you to stand. This is really easy to do. You are going to stand and walk about and say hello to someone. It's like milling about the room, or filling the space, or doing our act or weird. And as you say hello to a person, I shall demonstrate this now. I will say, hello, Natalie, and I will hand her my beloved card, let it go, and she will hand me hers, but I won't read it. I will just go to another person and say hello again and exchange cards, and I will read it. If you read, it will slow you down. So you just keep moving and moving and moving. So everybody stand. Okay, you're going to stand. This is really simple. You are going to stand. You are going to move about the room saying hello, and when you say hello, you exchange note cards. And in just a quick moment, I will stop you and give you another instruction. As you move, though, hold on, I'm getting too excited. Take your pen with you. You're going to need your pen or pencil. All right? Move, say hello, exchange cards, take your pen or pencil.
Numbers on that card, we'll promise off in just a moment if there's not.
you are going to add those numbers up and put the total number on the card. So the max number could potentially be 25, the low number could be 5. If you have, and this will happen, if you have extra numbers, just let's think positive, get rid of the low numbers. Inevitably with kids, there'll be extra numbers anyways. If you have only 4, give them that highest number a second time. We're gonna think positive today. So we're getting 5 numbers, add it up, this is the hard part. It really is. This is where I get a little nervous, the addition. It's not my strength. All right, what we're gonna do now, if you were in a smaller group, you could build a pyramid starting with the highest numbers. You start building a pyramid of ideas. And at Fusebox and in other places where I've done this, we actually program the festival using this activity with artists, with community folks, with activists. It is amazing what can be generated with note cards. And we're gonna gather these, anything over the 20 total we'll gather. But I just wanna hear, raise your hand if anybody's got a 25. And we're gonna have to use our
I've got one over here, Carra.
Okay, so what we're gonna bring the mic to you, it's got real prices right now. Can you share that idea with us?
Establish a land trust for poor and working class communities of color in East Austin. Develop jobs and businesses with the community that would make itself sustainable.
Awesome. We have another 25 way two over here.
Okay, I'm coming. I'm coming. Make way. We got 25.
Offer 0% interest loans to residents to purchase the property they inhabit.
Hell yeah, that's got 25. Oh, look.
There's another one. Right now, 25 is a gambit.
Build a McDonald's.
No, kidding.
Increase inclusive community process around city development, rent control, and vacancy control, and surveying of what community needs are and what's at stake.
24s. Raise your hand if you've got 24.
24. Oh, another closer.
Public and private partnership that required actually affordable housing mixed something to all central development.
Yes.
Yep.
Uh-huh.
Another
24.
Right here. 24.
Hey, I'm coming.
Just throw it.
Make incredible schools in all neighborhoods.
Yes. Yeah. Any other 24s?
The other 24s.
23s. Who's got a 23?
I got one. I got a hot one. I got a hot 23.
Land back to Native Americans and present Indigenous artist performance series.
Ow! That's 23. I'm coming, Miss Vicky.
I'm coming, Miss Vicky. I got 23 over here.
This is just a 12. Come together with the whole town to transform abandoned buildings into safe and warm homes with gardens and community projects.
There's another 23 right there. 23s.
Over there. All the way back over there. I'm weaving. I'm bobbing.
Right behind you. Have the artistic and creative community in Austin work with minority communities to preserve the cultural heritage and sacred spaces by joining politically passed bonds, elections to build or finish buildings, arts institutions to preserve and honor cultures.
I'm stealing that one. That one has everything all spelled out.
One here?
Okay. Come. Here we are. 23. Make it happen.
Law. If you are buying a building where you do not intend to live yourself for at least 6 months of each year, you must meet with all local residents within 3-block radius and consents around size use of property.
Awesome, yes.
We have one over here.
Okay. 3. This is the 23 song.
It's real. I would host dinners where the previous occupants of building and space in the neighborhood would join the current occupants to meet, talk, and share experiences and realities to combat the invisibilizing of histories.
And then we have one right
Okay, 23. Stand by,
23,
go.
Organized guerrilla-style intervention of potentially gentrifying neighborhoods, fill the street with crackheads, homeless brown people, and scare the shit out of all the white people. Free and stage gang violence. Whoever wrote this is great.
Anybody else with a 23? So this gives you an idea of how this activity works. Again, I want to go back and frame that when we're doing this kind of work, we're talking about the long game, not the short game. What we gave to you today was a kind of short game overview of some of the thoughts that different people in the conference have been having. But I want to point to, as you go about this process, it's really important to think through these conversations. How are you decentralizing power structures? How are you honoring the long history of a neighborhood and not just the current moment? So thank you for being with us in this conversation today. On Sunday, we're going to return to this.
Maybe.
I guess it depends on the rain.
I got a quick logistical thing. The ones that I gathered will hang out in the lobby, I guess, where like the photo booth stuff was, maybe, if there's space. If there's a badass idea in your hand right now that we didn't get to share and that you think you'd like to share with folks, you can put it up there too. Just with the card in your hand, if you think there's something you'd like to share, we're out of time to hear all the great ideas.
But thank you so much. Thank you so much. Have a good rest of your day.
Thank you. Big round of applause for all our panelists and facilitators. And you guys for doing that great work. Don't leave yet. Look at me. Please. I just have some announcements for you. Okay, NPN and Ben. First of all,